Hey, welcome back to my channel, ladies and gentlemen. So this is my top side deck and tech options for Archfiends in the August 2021 format. So these are tech options that are kind of unique to Archfiends. Not many other decks can really run them, or if they did, there would be probably more optimal solutions for them. But the unique thing about Archfiends is their ability to pump out level 8 fiend type monsters and level 6 or higher fiend type monsters through the likes of cards like Call of the Archfiend and Archfiend Empress. Here is my cat, ladies and gentlemen. And due to this, it enables us to get fairly easy access to that toolbox. This is kind of like my top 10 breakdown of unique cards that you could add into your side deck or even tech straight into the main deck. Also, this is in no particular order. I just sort of rolled them off as I thought of them. So coming in at number 10 is Invader of Darkness. So this monster, fantastic stat line, level 8 fiend. It's also a dark attribute, so it works quite well with the Dark Spirits and Archfiend Empress. Its stat line, 2900 attack, 2500 defense, really well balanced, really high as well for a level 8 fiend. And its effect is basically your opponent cannot activate any quick play spell cards. So if you're against a deck like Sky Strikers, for example, you have a very good advantage against them. So being able to stop all quick play spell cards means they can no longer drone, they can no longer activate Widow Anchor, they can't activate Shark Cannon. You pretty much shut down a lot of the spell cards in their deck, and its stat line means you're most likely going to get over monsters like Kagari and Shizuku with pretty much ease. Furthermore, even if Invader of Darkness happens to die, then you can also get access to Archfiend Empress and Call of the Archfiend to keep its presence on the field and keep stopping your opponent from activating quick play spells. It's also fairly useful against heroes, so that doesn't have a huge representation right now, but it's fairly useful because it can stop cards like Mask Change. It can also stop cards like Super Polymerization, which is a card that lots of people side deck these days. So in general, you can just have this card as the one-off in your side deck. You can dump it off of, say, Void Apocalypse, for example, and then you just revive it a bit later on. It's also useful for recycling your Dark Spirits as well. In general, it's just a really good level 8 fiend to have in your side deck, or sometimes teching straight into the main deck, depending on the format. Right, so coming in at number 9, we have the End of Anubis. So this is a really old card coming out in Ancient Sanctuary. It was actually the sort of like secret rare of the pack, the 000 of the pack, and it's fantastic artwork. It's probably one of my favorite artworks in the entire game, going all the way back that far, and its effect pretty much stops everything. So all spell, trap, and monster card effects that activate in the grave and target cards in the grave are just negated. So that can screw you over, right? When I say it counters everything, I pretty much mean it. So you have to be kind of careful when you use this card, but it shuts down the opponent a lot more than it does you. So if you can bring this out turn one, which is fairly simple to do, then on your opponent's turn, they pretty much have to prioritize getting over it. So Drytrons, for example, they summon themselves and they get all of their effects once they hit the graveyard. So having End of Anubis on the field just means half of their strategy has now been completely wiped out. Other card effects as well, like Eldritch trap cards, right, that banish themselves from the grave, that's not going to work. Anything that tries to revive from the grave, right, so all Phantom Knight strategies, they're all gone. It really hurts a lot of decks right now, so if you can have this in your deck, more the merrier. Call of the Archfiend, again, revives it pretty easily. Archfiend Empress revives it pretty easily. So all you have to do, if you have Fiendish Rhino Warrior and Void Apocalypse in your hand, turn one, you can bring it out during their standby phase, effectively. So what you want to do, activate Void Apocalypse, discard Fiendish Rhino Warrior, then you're going to send Archfiend Heiress, that's going to search for Call of the Archfiend, and then Fiendish Rhino Warrior is going to dump End of Anubis. Set Call of the Archfiend on their turn, activate it, summon End of Anubis, and see if you win fairly quickly from there. Also, since it has zero defense, it can synergize with cards like Reoccurring Nightmare, so since the Dark Spirits also have zero defense, you can use that to your advantage and recycle them back into your hand. You can even tribute to bring it out as well, because it's only level 6 and has 2500 attack as well, so you might even just win through a 2500 beatdown effectively, because you shut down all the graveyard targeting effects. So coming in at number 8 is Chaos Hunter. So this is a card that isn't really unique to Archfiends, because a lot of decks can utilize it, but because of its stat line, that makes it a little bit better to use in Archfiends in general. So it's level 7. Unfortunate that it's not level 8, but it is a Dark Fiend. Its stats are pretty decent as well. It's got 2500 attack, and basically, if it's in your hand and they special summon a monster, you special summon it onto the field, and cards now can no longer be banished. So Eldritch kind of screws them over. You can kind of stop Salamangreats a little bit as well, because they can banish their Balings, so that allows you to pretty much stop that in their track. Phantom Knights again, that's going to stop those in their tracks because they like to banish them from the graveyard, so that pretty much stops that. Counters Dino is pretty hard as well, so in general, Chaos Hunter, you know, really good as a side deck option in general, but for Archfiends it's just a little bit better, because once again, Archfiend Empress and Call of the Archfiend can revive it from the grave. So you could run it at 3 in a side deck, because then that means you get access to it turn 1, or you increase your chances of drawing it in turn 1. Or you can run it at like 1 and then just dump it off a Void Apocalypse and just bring it out later. So you have multiple options available to you that you wouldn't otherwise have if you just teched it into some other deck, for example. Right, now coming in at number 7 is also another card that is not unique to Archfiend builds. Lots of decks can side deck it in, and that's Gozen Match. So this makes sure that you only have one attribute on the field, and all other attributes have to be sent to the graveyard. More often than not, you're going to be running darks as an Archfiend deck, so just mono dark, with the exception of cards like Fiendish Rhino Warrior, but it always benefits you because you just get rid of the Rhino Warrior and then you get its effect, and you can send RS or you can send an Empress and recycle your Dark Spirits or whatever it might be. Having Gozen Match on the field just basically means you keep your presence up with high level Archfiends and high attack power, and your opponent, you kind of screw them over a lot of stuff. So if they're playing combo, most likely they're going to have access to a wide range of attributes, so they're going to have to think carefully and try and prioritize getting over Gozen Match. Sometimes it can just completely win you the game. So Prank Kids, for example, they're one of the decks that can use, there can be only one, but if you use Gozen Match against them, they're kind of locked into only having, you know, one of their Pranksies on the field, for example, or Dropsies or whatever it might be, and you kind of screw them over because of that. I've had games against Prank Kids that I've also won because I activated Gozen Match turn 1 and they couldn't get over it. They didn't draw Harpy's Feather Duster or whatever it was, for example, and they just couldn't do anything against me. So Gozen Match is a really powerful floodgate that you want to put in your side deck. Sometimes you might just want to throw it into the main deck as well as a 2 of or a 3 of, just because it is that powerful. Right, so coming in at number 6 is Darkness Neosphere. So this is another old card that goes back some time. And really, it's just a big beater. 4,000 attack, 4,000 defense, right? Fairly strong. But what it lets you do is when your opponent declares an attack, you just get one fiend from your field and one fiend in your hand, send them both to the graveyard, and then you can special summon it onto your side of the field. So that's useful, because you can recycle your Dark Spirits. You can get rid of like a dead card in your hand, right? If you've got Emperor or Empress or something, just send that to the grave. If you've just got some terrible card on your side of the field, or even if it is a level 8 on your side of the field, get rid of all of that. Summon Darkness Neosphere. You've got this pretty decent beater. You probably shove it in defense mode, and then you've got your Malice and your Dark Spirit of Banishment to also back your field up as well. So summon Archfiend Empress and keep that floating potential. It has a kind of an extra effect where you can return all your face-up trap cards to your hand, but you don't really do much in the way of trap card recursion. Like, Call of the Archfiend is the only one that you're going to use, to be honest, and you kind of want to keep that on the field. So only if your opponent has done something dodgy where they're going to get rid of it or they've negated it somehow, then sure, return it back to your hand. But really, you're just using it to be an extra beater on your side of the field. So again, it's a nice extender, like it's a nice option to keep your defense up. It's not the most powerful thing in the game, right? But it's an option to you that you might want to consider. Right, so coming in at number 5 is kind of like a duo here. So these are two monsters, one that's reliant on having certain criteria, another one is reliant on tribute summoning, and they are two Sky Scourge monsters. So you have Sky Scourge Invisil and Sky Scourge Norrellas. So these two monsters are fairly powerful in their own right, but they're just fairly slow. So Norrellas is crazy. If you have three fiends and a fairy type monster, banish those, and then what you can do once it's on the field, you just pay 1,000 life points and then you send everything from the field and hand into the graveyard. And then on top of that, you get to draw a card. So that's nice, isn't it? It's useful because if you've got monsters on your side of the field, most likely you're going to recycle your Dark Spirits, so you might plus off of that, but basically you want to use it to wipe everything. It's probably not a good idea to do it early on, because that probably sets their graveyard up with something, but sort of mid-game-ish, you can probably wipe everything. It's pretty much a Zeus. So if you wanted easy access to this, you could run some sort of Dogmatica engine, so you can use Dogmatica Punishment and then get rid of Entis, and then that will allow you to pop a card on the field, and then you've got her in the graveyard to banish for Norellus. So that is pretty useful. Beyond that, like I say, it's a fairly slow card, so if you've got this gimmicky type deck that you want to run this in, then go for it. But the other monster, Skyscourge Invisil, so once you tribute summon it, based on the attribute that you tributed, you can apply an appropriate effect. If you get rid of a light, it negates all spell cards, and if you get rid of a fiend, you negate all trap cards. So basically, you're going to be getting rid of a fiend type monster to summon this thing, and that's going to allow you to negate all trap cards, stopping the likes of Eldritch, for example. It might even help get rid of pesky cards like Imperial Order that they have on their side of the field. Tri-Brigades might have a problem with this as well, because Revolt will be negated. In general, yeah, fairly decent card. But to be honest, if trap cards are your problem, then you may as well run cards like Royal Decree. But this is a monster that can be splashed into an Archfiend deck, and it might just catch your opponent off guard as well. Right, so coming in at number 4, we have Koa'ki Meiru Doom. So this is a wind level 3 fiend type monster, and it can be absolutely devastating to your opponent. So once it's summoned, it's just a continuous effect, right? While it's on the field, it negates the effects of all light and dark monsters during the main phase. So Drytrons, it's gone, over, who cares? Red Eyes Dragoon, Verte Anaconda is going to be completely stopped by this thing. People might even think it's like a once per turn thing and they try to activate multiple cards. I've seen this happen. They either don't read it or they don't realize, and then they just have all their cards negated, and then they realize, ah, well, I can't do anything. So their best bet really is to summon something stronger than 1700 and try to attack over it. But in an Archfiend deck, you have access to Dark Spirit of Banishment. So if you summon it and activate, say, Void Apocalypse and get rid of, I don't know, Archfiend, and literally any level 8 fiend type monster, then Dark Spirit of Banishment is going to basically guarantee its protection, because there's no way they're going to get over 1700 attack against a level 8 fiend whilst it's negating cards. So if you're against a light or dark heavy deck, so any chaos type variant, right, Drytrons especially, any sort of like Phantom Knight deck or whatever it might be that's dark or light based, just throw this into the main deck and just win. In addition to that, you might want to run Diamond Core as well. So this is a spell card that isn't once per turn, and it just lets you search for a Koa'ki Meiru monster. So you can just activate it, bring Doom to your hand, and if you want as well, you can banish it from the graveyard to ensure that your Koa'ki Meiru monster doesn't get destroyed for that turn. So that can come in handy if you don't have any fiends in your hand. But most likely, you're going to have like a Dark Spirit to reveal or something like that. You want to pitch a Skarm, get Skarm's effect, and then you can reveal that one, and then that makes sure that your hand knowledge isn't so open to your opponent. So yeah, great card to run. Definitely put it in the side deck, particularly in this format. Lots of Drytrons running around, and you want to stop them in their tracks fairly early on. Okay, so coming in at number 2, we have Lava Golem. So Lava Golem is a kaiju, yeah, and it's one of the oldest kaijus going around, and most people might say, oh, you know, you can run Lava Golem in any side deck, really. But because it's also a level 8 fiend, it's fire, unfortunately, but that does allow you to summon it back through a Dark Spirit monster. And because Dark Spirits negate the effects of monsters that they summon, Lava Golem's burn damage doesn't apply to you. So that's perfectly fine. So what you want to do is just get rid of two of their monsters, right? Just throw that onto their side of the field. And then, on their turn, when they're going to get the burn damage inflicted to them, you have the opportunity to activate Dark Spirit of Malice to bring a monster on your side of the field. So it guarantees a Malice summon. All you have to do is anticipate whether or not they're going to pop your monster, or if they're going to banish it or something like that. So, you know, as long as you've got that knowledge there, having Lava Golem is great. As an Archfiend deck, you get access to Dark Spirit's Mastery as well, so that allows you to search for a level 8 fiend by discarding a card. You can search for Lava Golem, so being able to search a kaiju is a really powerful option, so having this in the side deck as your go-to kaiju monster is great. Additional kaijus, for example, you can run the level 7 interdimensional kaiju because it's also a fiend, but I just like Lava Golem because of that nostalgia factor, and also because his level 8 has a bit more synergy. Okay, so coming in at number 2, so this is another fiend-type monster that we get access to, and it's called the Suppression Pluto. So the Suppression Pluto, right, is a level 8 fiend-type monster. It can be special summoned fairly easily with multiple cards in your deck, but the effect is pretty decent. So what you do is you declare a card name, doesn't matter what it is, you look at your opponent's hand, so now you get access to everything in their hand. You can see what your opponent is going to be doing. Most likely you probably want to get something they've searched, or like an Ash Blossom, like, now try and see if they've got a hand trap, and if you declare it correctly, you can take control. You can either take control of a monster your opponent controls that doesn't target, so if they've got Dragoon, you just yoink that straight onto your side of the field. And it's not once per turn either. You take control of that monster forever. Really strong. And just to top it all off, it's once per turn. So it's soft once per turn. So you can summon this thing, take control of your opponent's monster, pop it with, I don't know, an Archfiend Emperor, or let's say a Annihilator Archfiend, right? Just get rid of it, bring it back through, say, Call of the Archfiend, and then do it again. And because you had access to their hand prior, then you're going to guarantee its effect is going to happen a second time. So it's really strong. Aside from taking control of your opponent's monsters, you can either destroy one of their spell and trap cards. And if you did that, then you also get to set it on your side of the field. So it's a really decent card, but it's kind of matchup dependent, right? So it's kind of up to you if you want to run it as a tech option in your deck. Personally, I prefer cards like Cursed Necrophyr because it has access to popping and it's self-revival. But Suppression Pluto, definitely. If you just want to fill a space in your deck with a level 8 fiend, then go for it. Just add this card into your deck and see how it works for you. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we get to our number 1 spot, which again, no particular order, right? I'm not saying this is the best tech option for Archfiends, but it's called Brain Golem. So this is a dark level 6 fiend type monster, which means you get access to it again through Empress and Call of the Archfiend, and it negates all light effect monsters on the field. So that gets over Herald of Perfection and Ultimateness, right? It kind of tries to stop Drytron monsters in their tracks. It's not as strong as like Koa'ki Meiru, for example, because Drytrons can then still activate their hand effects and graveyard effects, right? But again, if you're looking for a light floodgate, then Brain Golem's pretty decent, because also it's got 2500 attack, and if it destroys a light monster, it can attack again. So if you're looking for that decent like level 6 body on your side of the field that's fairly strong, then Brain Golem is an option for you. Again, it's just a tech, it's format dependent, but if you want to run something, if lights are pretty much wrecking your day at locals or wherever it might be, and you want to run something that Archfiends can easily bring out, then Brain Golem is pretty much the monster for you. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Those are my top 10 side deck or tech options that are kind of unique to Archfiends in some way, shape, or form. So if you liked this video, then my name's Adam. If you didn't, my name's Steve. And if you want to see more Archfiend-related duels, reviews, combos, and discussion, then feel free to have a browse. And if you want to see more of this content in the near future, then make sure you hit that notification bell so that you get notified when more content is released in the future. And until next time, ladies and gentlemen, I'll see you around.